Why, hello there. This is The Biscuit. How are you? I am fine. Thanks for asking. Today, we are brought to you this episode by Lucid Float Spas out of Mount Vernon, Ohio, as usual. But we are also brought to you and proud to announce a partnership with Hairless Ape Conspiracy. And you're going, hey, Biscuit, what's Hairless Ape Conspiracy? Well, I'll tell you what it's more than. It's more than just a t-shirt company with a catchphrase. It's a way of looking at the world, a way of seeing failure as an opportunity to improve past our one-time best, seeing hardship and tragedy as lessons taught in pain, sweat, and blood, viewing our small community as our tribe, and our tribalism as something to be professed and propagated. A way of seeing mortal life as a challenge to be bested, to be competed against, holding nothing back. Seeing our inner and outer strengths as our faith and depending on ourselves and our skills to be the things we count on when the challenges of life seems to be when the challenges of life seem to be winning. Our unique perspective is that we need to get back to the natural order of things. Quit being a pussy is basically the key thing here. Strengthening our bodies with hard work, strengthening our minds by seeking and gaining knowledge wherever we can find it, by like listening to The Biscuit. And this is a veteran-owned, veteran-operated company. I'm wearing a shirt right now. It's got a badass ape on it. It says violence as a gift. It says we hit on the back of it. The shirts are super, not thin, but comfortable. Not like weird thin where it's going to, you know, get fucked up in your mom's washer. But I love the company. I'm happy to be working with them. They fight hard. They love harder. And they do not stop until the dirt is thrown upon them. Go to the website, hairlessapeinc.com. Use the promo code BISCUIT10, get 10% off. That's going to give you free shipping plus a little more. Order yourself a t-shirt, help the biscuit out, help a veteran out, help yourself out. I get compliments on the shirts all the time. I love the company. I love the shirts. I wouldn't work with a company that I don't use and endorse. Today, we have Derek Helling on, a freelance writer, and he's written a good few pieces on CTE, so I wanted to get him on. Hope you guys enjoy. Thanks.
Now, Probert loose got the right hand. Free. He's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nyland, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt!
It's old time hockey.
Enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's The Biscuit. It's The Biscuit.
Damn it! That goal regulation size of what?
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. As a country will stop working on some badness fucking can.
Hi everybody. It's The Biscuit Podcast.
Hey, wanna go? Yeah, okay. Good luck, man.
All right, Biscuit Babies. Tonight I'm joined by Derek Helling, a freelance writer. You're probably familiar with his works featured in such publications as Heavy.com, Fansided, SB Nation, and Legal Sports Report, along with countless and countless of newspapers. Derek, how are you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you, sir?
Derek, you're also a Hawkeye, if I'm not mistaken, right?
That is correct, yes.
Hey, that's all right, Big Ten.
Yes, sir.
Did they have a hockey program there?
No, Iowa does not. About half the Big Ten does, half the Big Ten doesn't. Iowa is part of that half that doesn't.
Does it snow in Iowa?
Yes, it does. It does. It does a lot, actually. We don't get as much ice as we do here in Kansas City, Missouri, where I now reside.
Uh huh.
But more snow there in eastern Iowa.
So, man,
yeah.
You think they'd
get plenty of winter weather.
Yeah, you think they'd get some good hockey players there to Iowa.
Yeah, I mean, they're just really, I mean, there's a minor league team in the Quad Cities, which is an area in further eastern Iowa than Iowa City, where the University of Iowa is at. But it's actually on the Illinois side of the river,
okay.
Not on the Iowa side. And there just really isn't. There really isn't a strong presence for the sport in the state.
Yeah, I guess in the winter most people are wrestling there in Iowa. That's pretty huge wrestling.
Yeah, wrestling is king in the state of Iowa.
So
that has a lot to do with it.
That's weird. We were just talking about the Quad Cities today, and I was like, man, I don't even know where that is. So it's the Mallards there that are the Quad City Mallards?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah, but they actually, like I said, they actually play on the Illinois side of the Quad Cities. So technically they're not in Iowa.
Oh, okay. Well, hey, man, that's awesome. I wanted to get you on. I've been really interested in CTE, and I had stumbled upon a few of your pieces throughout the year. I forget which one it was in particular, maybe one of the latest ones, but you really have a good eye on it because you studied in law too, so you take at it at a different perspective than most sports writers because you kind of know the dealings in a courtroom. Was that why you kind of tackled the issue of CTE in hockey and contact sports in general?
Yeah, it's something that has really been kind of sidestepped in the courts, not because there has been an absence of litigation in that regard. You know, we just saw a case against the NCAA settled a month ago about. But just because of that very fact that none of these have all been civil cases, and they've all been settled out of court so far. We've yet to see a CTE case really go the full length of the trial and actually have a ruling be handed down upon. And that's, you know, neither here nor there. It's the job of the attorneys representing these clients to get the best deal possible for them. And I would say that to a certain degree, maybe that's been accomplished. In the NFL case, that is certainly not the case. The NFL really got a sweetheart deal with the settlement that it worked with. It's with the class of players that it had to deal with. So we'll see what happens in this NHL case that is ongoing right now as we speak.
Now, did the NFL sue as the Players Association, or was it individual players like what's going on now in the NHL?
Yeah. No, it was like the NHL case, it was just a class of former NFL players. The NFLPA itself was the party in that case.
And did the NFL settle before the BU study that came out where – correct me if I'm wrong, but was 111 of the 112 brains that had been studied had shown signs of CTE?
Yeah. No, the NFL settlement was announced about this time of year in 2013. So it's been
So quite some time ago.
Yeah.
It really seems like that would put up a big flag for the NHL as far as trouble coming your way when you have something like that. Where that study, I mean, that study's frightening that is coming out like that when, you know, for practically everyone that played, I mean, cause that study was from people that played high school football up into the professional level. If I'm right there.
Yeah. The results of the BU research, as a whole have not been good for professional sports leagues so far.
And did that lead into the NHL starting to tamper in and try to get that information from a third party, which is illegal, which led to another case that they had to deal with, that they ultimately had to pay BU, BU's legal fees?
Yeah, basically what happened was Boston University researchers were studying the brains of deceased hockey players. The NHL wanted all of the data from their research, and BU said no, because that's going to taint the results of our study that's ongoing if we have to hand over all our data to you, because for a couple of reasons. Number one, families of these deceased players may be less willing to have the brains of their loved ones donated to the program if they know that the NHL is and other people are going to have access to the data that comes from the research.
Oh, for sure.
And secondly, you know, anytime you have a party with an obvious interest in the outcome of your research involved to that degree, it's going to tamper and compromise the efficacy of your research. The BU did cooperate with them to a certain degree, but the NHL went all, the raw data, everything. And the NHL took BU to court over that, and saying that they had a material interest in acquiring all this data to prepare and present a case in the, you know, the case, the lawsuit that's ongoing in a federal court in Minnesota right now.
Wouldn't that seem like a bad idea for the NHL to go after that? I would assume they have incredible lawyers with them, but to me, when I hear that, you know, not being a lawyer myself, but I think, well, why would they think that they could get that information? Because in any other case, that wouldn't happen. I don't know why they were thinking that did they just think, well, we're the NHL, we're just going to get it?
I think to a certain degree, it was just a matter of kind of maybe what do we have to lose?
Okay.
If we win this case, then we get everything that we want. If we lose, then we aren't really out anything because we don't have that data right now anyway.
Right.
So they lost the case, and then, as is common.
And that was the case that ended up them having to pay about 80% of BU's legal fees?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, as is common, when you file a civil suit and you lose, it's pretty common for the defendant to ask the court to order you to cover a chunk of their legal fees. So that's pretty common, because, well, once again, the entire reason why BU had to hire those lawyers is just because the NHL sued them. So,
and doesn't it kind of seem like it's releasing the stench of guilt too from the NHL when they have comments before the lawsuit started, you know, Bettman saying, I've seen the interviews, you know, that there's no correlation, you know, between concussions and playing hockey. And now it's like, oh, we need to buy these documents and these test studies to kind of hide that there might be a correlation. Seems most certainly that there is in, you know, playing a contact sport and then having CTE.
Yeah, it's definitely inconsistent where if you really believe that there's no correlation, or actually, I mean, the NHL is currently taking that a step further right now and saying that CTE is fabrication.
God, I didn't realize they were going flat earth on it until I read one of your articles.
Yeah.
How insane is that? That's a mockery.
They have medical professionals who obviously have integrity and ethics issues. But they hold those titles regardless.
So if you didn't hear what
they've paid money to,
If you didn't hear what Derek just said, the NHL is actually saying that they don't even believe that CT is real, that there's no proof of it yet.
Yeah.
They've actually came out and said that.
Yeah, that's the company line that their quote unquote medical professionals are towing right now. If you really believe that, then it's in your best interest for a third party to conduct research and prove you're right.
Yeah, to solidify it, for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. Trying to meddle with a study with one hand while with the other hand you're saying we don't believe that this disease actually exists is definitely an inconsistency.
And they've been going at it, in some instances, pretty dirty, too. There's been allegations of them paying doctors to, tell players different things that led to them playing injured, especially in the case of Mike Peluso. The burning and the disappearing of certain documents that had information from doctors at that time saying that these guys can't play. Now this stuff is just gone.
Yeah,
and I don't think. What's that?
Go ahead.
And I don't think a lot of players in the 80s, mid 90s were keeping documents like that from because it wasn't really a thing yet. If you're a dude now, you're probably keeping every piece of paper that says anything about your brain just because of the steps that these players have taken to start this lawsuit now and really bring awareness. The NFL, too, that CT is real. To think that, CT is fake, that still shocked me. I was reading some of your work just the other day, and I read that, and I was like, you got to be kidding me.
To me, it's more ridiculous than climate change denial, and to me, it borders on Holocaust and flat Earth. On Holocaust denial and flat Earth.
It's right. It's got to be right up there.
Yeah. Because you're saying that all these people had all these symptoms when they were alive. That are exactly the same.
Yeah, correlating symptoms.
Yeah, and they scan their brains after they're deceased, and the atrophy is exactly the same, and that's all coincidental.
And they can see the CT because there's certain parts of the brain that are swollen.
Yeah, you look at a normal deceased brain, and you looked at a CTE deceased brain, and you can see the atrophy right there in front of you. And so there's the NHL saying that that's all coincidental.
But on their side too, it's going to take a hell of a lot, because it's up to the plaintiff to challenge the NHL beyond a doubt, which is not easy to do.
Well, in a civil case, the standard of reasonable doubt doesn't exist. That only exists in criminal cases, which this is a civil case.
Okay.
So basically, yes, the burden is still on the plaintiffs, though. But this is kind of they're making the same allegations that every other CTE case has, that the NHL either knew or by right should have known of the dangers that existed for hockey players resulting from head trauma playing its brand of hockey and failed to inform the players of those risks, because as an employer in the United States of America, that's your responsibility,
right? And then even some cases endangering said players that they knew were hurt basically forcing them to, either play or lose your job.
Yeah,
which like you said, at the end of the day, it's an employee-employer relationship, and. That would go against, OSHA. You can't work injured. If I'm, shut up in my house and I can't see, I have to wear sunglasses to get me from the sun, probably shouldn't be playing hockey that night.
Yeah, I agree.
And then when you have doctors telling you, oh, hey, you can't play tonight. You can't play the rest, for a couple weeks. And you walk into the office and the owners and managers are going, oh, no, you're playing. We got the clear. The team doctor said you're good. That's who we go by.
Yeah, and what choice do you have? There's some players who, the team wouldn't be able to dismiss easily because of their contracts. But there are other players who, are on the fringe.
Yeah.
Of having a roster spot. And, just like with former NFL players that I've spoken with doing writing, you want that spot badly, and so you're willing to do whatever you can to hold on to it once you've gotten it.
Yeah, when you've worked your entire life to get to that point, and then, like you said, some of these fringe players, this is the one shot they have of literally changing their life forever. You could make enough money playing one season in the NHL to be okay for quite some time.
Yeah.
So you would do anything, and then especially if you trust your team, you want to trust your owners, and you definitely want to trust the team doctors, and you're being lied to the whole time. And
it's a tragic and unfortunate situation.
Now, How did they uncover these, the allegations of paying doctors and burning documents? Was that something that came along after they kind of pissed off BU?
Well, I think it's just a matter of the players themselves reporting these instigations. So we'll see if that ends up being part and parcel to the concussion case. As it plays out right now, the big question in the case is whether or not this is going to be a class of hundreds of former players or a smaller class just involving the original plaintiffs.
And that's something that the NHL would probably want to keep at the small number that it is now, because ultimately be a lot easier and cost effective for them to pay out of court settlement on the handful of guys that are suing now rather than hundreds of players or the whole NHLPA, and then continue to play insurance for, I don't know how that works in the NHL, but I'm sure if you play so many games, you would think that there's some kind of insurance after hockey, or I would hope that maybe this will lead to something like that.
Yeah. I mean, the NHLPA has lifetime health benefits for his players once you record a certain number of time at the NHL level.
Right. But that would probably only be for things that they think are real, right? So if they went...
No, yeah, I mean, well, the NHLPA is the one that takes out the policy, not the NHL. It's whether or not that's going to be sufficient to care for these players as they age and as the degeneration of their mental faculties continues, is just going to depend on the individual and what course that takes.
When did you start working on this particular case with the NHL? Has it been the last, couple years that you had started on it?
Yeah. It's a couple of years old now for as far as, documents were first filed and, players have joined over the time, and then, the whole thing with BU got involved. And we're still waiting to see whether or not that class is going to get certified right now. And that's really what everything's kind of hinging upon right now. Doesn't get certified.
Yeah, did you jump on this right away when you heard about it and started investigating yourself immediately?
Yeah, pretty much. Because when it first started, I didn't really know how far it would go. It just would depend on how many former players would jump on to the bandwagon. So the fact that there's a class of potential hundreds of players ready if that to be certified definitely made it something worth the time and effort for me to spend researching and writing about. And so I guess the rest is kind of history from there.
Yeah. And I know the pieces that I had read were on FanSided. I think there was a series that you had wrote for them. And it really... you hear about CTE, and then I've spent and had conversations with certain former players, and it really makes your stomach turn when you know that there's days where these guys can't get out of bed, and it's directly correlated with them taking hits and using their body as gladiators for years and years and years, and you read stuff like this where they're trying to. This is one of the questions I had. They're trying to disallow testimonies from expert witnesses. I wanted you to kind of explain exactly what that means and what exactly is an expert witness.
An expert witness is someone who, pretty much what the term says, is someone who is qualified to speak on a topic.
So would that be the players themselves?
Well, to a certain degree, I guess you could consider a player, an expert witness. It would depend on, where you're going with that testimony. The contention in this case has been over pretty much the medical professionals and kind of their I guess, stance on CTE and neurological disease as a whole. And that's really been the point of contention in this case over, because obviously the story that gets weaved for the court, if and when this case actually goes to trial, and it's completely possible that it may never see the courtroom, would definitely have a lot to say about what the result of that trial would be. So that's going to be as much a point of contention as the certification of the class.
Now, do you think it makes it to court?
I don't think it goes all the way through a trial. The trial may start, but I can't see it going all the way to the end.
I wouldn't think so either, just because if the NFL settled out, I wouldn't imagine they will.
Yeah.
That they'll go any further than that.
No. How quickly it gets settled is going to depend on whether or not the class gets certified.
Right.
If the court denies the certification of the class, it'll get settled very quickly. Because the NHL will want to put this to bed as quickly as possible. And it'll be significantly cheaper, as you mentioned.
Right.
If the class does get certified, it'll take some more time to work out a settlement.
Now, just to go back to that, the disallowing of the testimonies, they're saying because there's different advice or different testimonies from, you know, a certain expert witness here than a witness that they would have. So they are basically saying that these just cancel each other out because they're conflicting information.
I mean, that's definitely possible. I mean, you could have, you know, doctors that the plaintiffs put on the stand and doctors put on that the defendants put on the stand, representing conflicting testimony.
God, that's bizarre. Issues.
And it'll be up to, you know, the presiding judge and, you know, the jury to decide who to believe, I guess, in that instance.
And what court would see this? Is this a Supreme Court issue?
No. It is currently before a federal court in Minnesota.
Okay. So it just seems crazy that a doctor, you know, any kind of doctor with any sort of character could say CTE is fake. I just don't see how you could have ever read a book and say that.
Money talks, sir. Money
yeah,
talks.
No shit, right?
Yeah.
God, that's especially when you're in a room with these guys too. But I guess, like you said, they're around death and all that kind of stuff all the time, and then money.
Yeah.
Money is a big factor in that, those kind of situations. And with someone that has that kind of moral compass and swing on them, I guess a dollar would be a little more important than sleeping well at night, because you could just pop some Ambien or whatever and go night-night. In your honest opinion, do you think that the NHL knew that they were endangering players and hid this information from players at that time?
I don't think that there was like a jointed, concerted, like back alley, I guess to put that term to it, meeting at any point where, you know, the leadership and owners of the league and owners got together and were like, wringing their hands together like Snidely Whiplash and being like, we know that we're destroying these people's brains, but we're just not going to tell them. And,
right.
You know, I don't think there was ever a moment like that on a massive scale.
Right. Yeah,
There may have been conversations, I guess, sort of to that effect between individuals at certain points. I think it's just been more in the course of the daily operations of operating an NHL franchise. And you want you've invested money in these players. Your fans, who are your customers, are paying money to see them on the ice.
Yeah.
So it's natural to want to give your customers the best product possible. And, you know, winning hockey games produces revenue.
Right.
And that's what this is all about. And a lot of NHL fans need to remember that NHL franchises are businesses first and foremost. They're not in the business of hockey. They're in the business of selling and marketing hockey. Hockey is their product. And so profit is always going to be the first and foremost motivation. And
yeah, that bottom loyalty, line.
And loyalty in any and every situation, not just this.
Now, I wouldn't be surprised if they even didn't even care to look into it. Like, were they just, like, you know, just get out there, boy, it's time to play. Like, I don't even think, I wouldn't be surprised if that was the case. And like you said, there might have been rumblings eventually when, like, maybe, you know, some of the older guys, they had seen them and went, oh, shit, maybe we are ruining these guys' lives, and maybe that it started to get a roll in there. But they still, like you said, if they can get away with it, they're going to. If they can send somebody out there, you know, who, you know, might end up getting in a fight and, you know, selling jerseys and getting the crowd riled up, selling some beer in there, they're going to do it at the end of the day.
Yeah. Yeah. I think an important thing to point out is that these injuries aren't just the result of fighting.
Oh, no, not by any means.
But you don't have to have an impact directly to your head to get a concussion. You can get concussed from experiencing whiplash or an impact to other parts of your body. That is significant enough to cause your brain to shift inside of your skull.
Yeah, because a concussion can happens. Yeah, I think in Ice Guardians it even says a shot to your chest might cause a concussion more, because it's causing that whiplash and that brain to shake more than just. Not just, but a punch to the face isn't as vicious as getting crushed to the chest and having your head whipped back and hit the boards or something in that effect.
So, I mean, that stuff, that happens all the time in hockey.
Oh, yeah.
So the question is whether or not that force is enough to cause the brain to shift inside the skull, as far as whether or not it causes a concussion, not necessarily where the impact was.
Right. Have you seen Ice Guardians?
Yes, I have. Yeah.
It's good shit, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It really was.
I was going to say, that's a remarkable piece. And they go into which we were just mentioning. Where do you think this goes in the future? Do you think that in, say, 25 years, we're going to be playing hockey even?
Yeah, I definitely think so. I think it's too well entrenched in the culture of both the United States and Canada for a not on just a professional level, but youth going on up to be completely eradicated. Maybe if you ask me in a few hundred years, would we be playing hockey? I could honestly say I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Because I kind of look at American football and real football, what a lot of people call soccer. And because there's a lot of people that are getting concussions as a result of playing that sport as well. And hockey, in a few hundred years, human beings might look back at it kind of similar to how we look back at the gladiatorial games.
Yeah.
In ancient Rome, and be like, man, that seems really brutal and barbaric. So I think in a few hundred years, maybe human beings will look back and say, man, why were these people doing that? but in 25 years, no, I think it'll still be around. What it could look like in 25 years could be decided to a large degree by how this case ends up.
Yeah, I agree with you. You could see some changes in rules, maybe even if this goes if it actually makes it to court.
Yeah, and that might be part of the settlement, as opposed to the NHL just writing a check.
And they just tried to settle out of court with Peluso, didn't they? And he denied their offer.
Yeah,
which was a huge thing in this case as it moved forward.
Yeah, he seems determined to affect change and not collect change at this point. You know, he may end up doing both.
Right. And he's one of the guys that said that he was just straight up lied to by doctors.
Yeah. I mean, that's been his stance all throughout. And so it's going to be on his – the burden's going to be on him to prove it if it does go to trial.
And that's Mike Peluso who I'm talking about for the listeners. Well, Derek, I mean, this is really good work, and the way you're writing it from that, you know, kind of law base that you have is really interesting, and I look forward to, you know, continue following your story as this unfolds. Just a few more questions for you. Are you a Blues or Wild guy?
Neither.
Blackhawks.
I could probably give you 25 guesses, and you wouldn't come up with who my favorite NHL team.
I'm gonna give me two more here. Is it West Coast or East Coast?
East Coast.
Is it Original Six?
No, it is not.
Jesus Christ. If it's something that there's no Carolina Hurricanes.
Nope. But you're getting close to it.
Who is it?
I am the only Florida Panthers fan I know of in Kansas City, Missouri.
You're the only Florida Panthers fan I know, period. How the hell does that happen?
Well, I grew up in Iowa, as you know, as we've already mentioned.
Yeah.
And there are no professional teams in any sport in the state of Iowa, so you can be a fan of whoever you want.
Is it like that in Iowa there? It's just a free-for-all?
Yeah, I love it. It's wonderful, because I've always been an advocate of geography doesn't have to determine your fandom.
It shouldn't, I guess, especially now.
Yeah, because you don't, as a child, you don't really decide where you're going to live.
No, you don't at all.
Yeah, so I've always been an advocate of that, even if you grow up in a place where the NHL has a presence, that you don't necessarily have to be a fan of that franchise.
But goddamn, man.
Whoever you want.
That might have been my last pick.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say. I could probably give you 25 guesses.
Dude, that's crazy.
So I was just like, you know, so when they came into the league as an expansion franchise, I was a teenager. I didn't have a favorite NHL team, so I was like, yeah, I'll go with them.
Dude, that was the same way I started rooting for the Raptors and the Cavaliers when I was younger. I was like, I like this. This is new. I was like, I'll follow the Raptors.
Yeah.
I was like, why not?
Yeah. That was it. Yeah.
I think that's happened a lot more for younger kids with the internet because it's a lot easier. I mean, it seems to me that younger kids, like my younger son is strictly just like a Brett Burns fan, like doesn't give a shit about the rest of the NHL. Like, but if Brett Burns is on the ice, he's like, okay, now it's time. And I'm like, oh, no, dude, come on. I'm like, you have to like my team.
Yeah, well, I think there's a difference between our generation and younger generations. I think we see this a lot in the NBA, especially where younger fans aren't as dedicated about following a team as they are just a certain player.
Well, especially the NBA, because I mean the players themselves have zero loyalty to an organization.
Yeah,
and I don't blame them. I mean, go get your money while you can.
Absolutely. Yeah, I never fought a player your window is so small and it can end so quickly.
Yeah.
I'm always, you can get yours while you can because, I mean, tomorrow's not guaranteed to you at all as a professional athlete.
I mean, and you're a fool to think that you wouldn't do it yourself. Like, if you don't kid yourself. Yeah. If someone was like, hey, I'll pay $154 million to come over here instead of the $12 million, you're going.
Yeah, absolutely.
Derek, man, this has been great, dude. I'm really glad to have you on. Where can the listeners find you at?
You can find me on Twitter at @dhellingsports. That's dhelling. And Instagram, Derek Helling Sports. That's about it. And you know, as soon as we get any more developments on this front, where the court in Minnesota decides whether or not it's going to certify the class, of course I'll be on that, and there'll be a lot of fallout from that. So whenever that happens,
are you working on anything else at the time, or just kind of enjoying the summer off?
Well, right now I'm currently working on some non-hockey stuff, sports betting, which of course is going to become an NHL issue.
Hell yeah!
Very soon. And just some kind of local stuff here in Kansas City.
Hell yeah, man. And for all the listeners, I can't recommend his pieces on CTE. Then you can find those at fansided.com.
Yeah. Yeah, you just go to fansided.com/art/author/ my first and my last name, and then the word sports, and everything that I've written for that site will come up.
Awesome.
Or if you want to, dig through my Twitter feed, I don't know why, but
people got time, man.
It's there.
People got time. They'll be cruising through that. I'm telling you what. After they hear you're a Florida Panthers fan, they're going to find a lot of intrigue in you. They're going to be, what the hell is up with this dude? Derek, thanks a lot, man. I appreciate you, ladies and gentlemen. That was Derek Helling, the Florida Panthers fan. Hell yeah, Biscuit Babies. That was Derek Helling, freelance writer for Fansided, SB Nation, Heavy.com, and other publications all around the great United States of America. That was really interesting shit. I'm glad to have him on. Make sure you go follow him. And make sure to go follow Hairless Ape Conspiracy on Twitter and Instagram, and let them know the Biscuit sent you their way. The more you guys, go there and support the Biscuit, the more I can work with this company. And the more I can offer you guys shit from them too. They're really, really awesome. These guys are badass. Veteran operated and veteran owned. And their mission is to increase our influence, spread our dogma, and create a brand that is true to our patrons as they are to their passions. And their shit's cool, man. I really dig the hairless ape, with the actual hairless ape on it, with him screaming. I recommend that shirt. I recommend all their shirts. I've got 3 or 4 of them, and I literally haven't taken them off unless I am shirtless, which I am quite a bit, slamming the bats in the backyard. All right, love you guys. Be safe. I'll talk to you soon. iTunes, rate and review us. And go check out Fourth Line Voice's new podcast he has out, the Fourth Line Voice podcast. Bye-bye. How many bucks do I give?